share his insights on various issues. We also collected your specific queries, so you know that we can provide you the specific answers to your queries, and we can make a useful webinar for you all. Thank you, Mr. Rastogi. I think maybe we can start this webinar now.
Yeah.
So I would request you to take over and start the presentation. Then we can have the question and answer session, and we can take up the query. Over to you. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. So are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
So thanks a lot to all of you for attending this webinar. And I think how we would want to keep this webinar would be more interactive. So while there are a lot of interesting things with respect to credits, which we intend to discuss with respect to some of these provisions related to anti-profiteering, the arrest provisions, and last but not the least, taxability of intermediaries. But, and there are certain questions which have come already to us. We will try to address that during the course of the presentation. But I think we'll try to keep this more interactive so that a lot of these questions are addressed. And the ultimate objective of answering you and resolving your queries is ultimately achieved. So I think when we talk about the credits, the most important aspect is with respect to that this is my cash. And this credit, if it is utilized in a proper mechanism, it becomes a part of the credit chain and I utilize that. And hence it is very important to see very aspects related to these credits. Now, why I say that this credit remains an endless dispute is it is not only this GST regime, but even the erstwhile regime prior to GST, there were a plethora of disputes with respect to these credits. Today, as we speak, we are privileged to have the great decision from the Delhi High Court with respect to brand equity, in which the courts very, very clearly held that credit is my vested right. And we will go into the details of those cases. But again, coming to why this remains an endless dispute is because even in spite of such a great decision from the Delhi High Court, today we have the challenge of retrospective amendment. Just a couple of days back, retrospective amendment has happened with respect to this benefit, which has been given by Delhi High Court. So we will go on to that as well and see that, you know, how these issues could be resolved in the days ahead. So I would want to start with respect to the denial of transitional credit on account of these procedural lapses, this decision which we argued in Delhi High Court. And basically the decision predominantly lays down that credit is my vested right. So I would not touch into detail of this decision as of now. I have specific slides for that. But the moot point before the court was, can the benefit of transitional credit, the credits from my erstwhile regime coming to the current regime, can that benefit be denied by fixing a time limit? So what happens if I have not taken the credit for different reasons, including the reasons that I forgot to take that credit? Is this my right? Is what the court has held in brand equity case in Delhi High Court. And it was very, very clearly held that it becomes my vested right and it becomes the right to property, and hence I will be eligible to take the benefit not during the limited time period of 90 days which is prescribed in the rules, but in a period of 3 years. There are a lot of other disputes with respect to the credits which we have taken to the courts. One of the other dispute was with respect to the pre-GST stock. So for instance, if the GST came into effect from 1st of July 2017 and I had my stock. So the provisions provided that you could take the credit of only those stocks which were procured within a period of 1 year prior to this date. We challenged that provision and said that this is my vested right and hence the benefit with respect to these credits should not be restricted to the stock only for that 1 year, But this transitional credit benefit should be given to the stock of even the earlier period. Fortunately and unfortunately, today we have both the favorable and the unfavorable decision from the perspective of the taxpayer. While Bombay High Court in the case of JCB ruled out that such transitional credit would be limited to a one-year stock, and Gujarat High Court in case of Philco ruled that this provision is constitutionally not valid. And hence, as we speak today, there are two contradictory decisions. What we did as a smart thing before the Delhi High Court was to get an interim relief, at least so that the taxpayers get the benefit of the credit with respect to these transactions. And hence, in any case, the ultimately decision will be taken by the Apex Court, which is not very far from now. So from that perspective, I would again want to reiterate that disputes with respect to these credits remain an endless dispute, especially in light when different high courts have taken different views on these important aspects. The third very important issue with respect to the transitional credit is with respect to the exclusion of transitional credits for computing net ITC benefit for the export purposes. We challenged this provision also, and we said that an exporter who would get the benefit of the credit by applying the formula of net ITC should not be restricted in any way with respect to the transitional credits also, which comes from the previous regime to the current GST regime. And why that question was raised was that in case this credit does not become part of the net ITC, then it becomes a tax cascading situation. What will happen to those credits, especially in cases of those exporters who have 100% exports? So from that perspective, I think most of these writ petitions, which I have argued in last two and a half years, are more on the equity jurisdiction of these courts. To me, what is more important is that the logic is brought before the court in a very, very lucid, simple, plain words, so that the court understands the hardship which is being faced by the taxpayers. And hence, in most of these issues addressed by different high courts throughout the country, the equity jurisdiction has been used by most of these courts so that the fairness is reflected and the decision is based on the fairness and the hardship of the taxpayers is addressed. Another issue is with respect to the ITC accumulation on account of restriction of rebate benefit. The two benefits which are today prevalent is the rebate and the refund benefit. It has happened by way of restriction in Rule 96-10 that five of such benefits of procurement under different schemes such as deemed exports, advance authorization, and so on and so forth, there are restrictions which are placed in terms of obtaining the benefit of rebate, which means that the only option which you would have would be with respect to the refund mechanism. So we challenged that as well, so that this option also goes on to Hello,
sir, are you making your presentations?
Yeah, can you see the presentation?
I think so. Someone has written in the chat box. They are not even I'm not able to view the presentation.
Okay, just a moment. Ryan,
sir, just go to a share screen option.
Yeah, share screen
option and select the presentation.
Can you see it now?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Now it is visible.
Yeah.
Now it is visible? Okay. Yeah. I hope I am audible also.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everyone is fine with the speed and everything. So, yeah. Then we
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
So should I quickly repeat the 3 points or should we continue?
No, we should continue.
We should continue. Okay. In any case, we can come back at any point of time. Now, with respect to the blocked credits, the credits have had been subject to a lot of these restrictions under Section 17. And today, even in the COVID situation, this is the current problem which a lot of businesses are facing, is with respect to the goods which would be damaged. So for instance, if these retail outlets, factories, etc., are closed for a longer period of time, and for instance, if I am a manufacturer or a retailer of, let's say, leather bags, shoes, etc., there are high chances that these goods would be damaged. I would not be able to sell these goods once the market is normal. Now, what happens with respect to the block credit condition is that the provision says that in case these goods are damaged, the credit which has been taken with respect to these damaged goods would have to be reversed. Now, imagine a situation wherein the retailer or a manufacturer has incurred the GST on the procurement of these goods, also becomes subject to the cost with respect to the tax, which has become a brunt to that person. So for instance, if I have a retail shop, I bought goods, the goods got damaged, I'm not able to recover the output consideration on the goods, but at the same time, the law would say that you would have to reverse the credit which I have availed on these goods. So this is a practical problem, a big problem, and this would fall within the definition of the block credits of Section 17. So it is not only this block credit, but also a lot of these construction related block credits. So for instance, if there are works contract services which are being procured for construction of the immovable property, or when goods and services are procured on own account for construction of these immovable properties, there is specific provision of 17.5C, 17.5D. And with respect to the goods damaged, free samples and gifts are covered under 17H. Now, what happens in all of these situations, including free samples and gifts, is that you will have to reverse the credit if that has come to your books, which means that the entire objective of tax credit has gone for a toss. And why I want to say that is that the objective of GST was very, very simple, that there will be seamless flow of credits. Now, if such restrictions are placed, it creates a big problem. And hence, in multiple writs which we have filed all across the country, we have challenged all of these provisions with respect to the block credits. What we have not challenged so far, but is again very relevant, is with respect to credits on cars. When these cars are used for business purposes, only in very, very few situations these could be allowed in terms of the credits. But in most of the other situations, these credits are not allowed even on cars. So I think most of these restrictions which are coming in Section 17 will have to be tested. And I think the logic of the GST was very clear, and the objective was also very clear, that there will be seamless flow of credit. And if there is no seamless flow of credit today, then I think the courts will have to see the fairness with respect to these blocking of credits. Very interesting last bullet on this slide, and this came from one of the person who's attending the presentation today. And the question is, what happens with respect to those transitional credit on capital goods which are taken by exporters so whether these exporters would be eligible to get the benefit of the capital goods. So the issue is addressed by way of explanation to Section 54, and the explanation very clearly divides the entire thing into four parts. Interestingly, if you would see that if you are basically opting the benefit of rebate, then in that situation, you could avail the credit on capital goods, because you are utilizing the credits of capital goods for offsetting the liability which you are paying on those exports and taking the benefit of the tax paid. But when it comes to refund of the taxes, there is a restriction. So as compared to rebate, the refund situation places on the capital goods because of the specific usage of the word inputs and input services in the explanation. So, and if we go ahead, then there is deemed export also, in which also the benefit with respect to the capital goods would come. Last but not the least, Section 54 subsection 3 also talks about the inverted duty structure. And in case of inverted duty structure, the words which are being used is unutilized ITC. And if we see the meaning of ITC, which is input tax credit, in Section 2, subsection 62, the ITC would use the word goods, which means this would include both the inputs and the capital goods. So the conclusion which is now there is that with respect to the capital goods, when the option of refund is taken, then the benefit of credit with respect to these capital goods is not available, which is completely arbitrary. Because in all the other three cases, when you go in for the rebate option, when you go for the deemed export, or when there is an inverted duty structure refund, in all of these three situations, you could in some way or the other use the benefit of this credit with respect to the capital goods, but not on the refund mechanism, which in itself is arbitrary, needs to be challenged. And I think appropriate amendment will have to be carried out in the explanation so that that restriction is not limited. The other point on which we have already filed the writ petition is with respect to the transitional credit on capital goods, which are procured by units in exempted zones. So for instance, there are these exemptions in Uttarakhand, etc. And these exemptions transitioned into the GST regime if the capital goods were procured just before the implementation of the GST. Is there a possibility by which this credit could not go to the next regime? And the answer is that there are restrictions with respect to the transitional credit. The only way that these restrictions could now be addressed is to take the issue to the court so that the constitutional validity of such a restriction is challenged before the court. And again, the fairness comes into play. So from that perspective, I think to answer clearly the question which was posed is that with respect to the refund option, the credit on capital goods would not be available. It is completely arbitrary. There is a pure need to go to the court and knock the doors of the court for this issue. There was a related issue with respect to the reverse charge mechanism, whether the credit with respect to the reverse charge mechanism would be available. And the answer is yes. Those credits, there are no restrictions. Moving on to the next slide. Reverse charge on procurement from unregistered suppliers, I think this was a big issue which we had taken in the initial days of GST to the court. The provision was that reverse charge would be made applicable in case the procurements are from the unregistered dealers, which means that if a registered business entity would procure from the unregistered supplier, the tax is required to be paid on the reverse charge mechanism. We challenged this provision on the very simple basis that there is a requirement to keep these people out of the threshold. And if the reverse charge mechanism is applied on such transactions, people will be discouraged to deal with these unregistered suppliers. So the issue was not only with respect to the credit, which would be available, but was also with respect to the compliance, which would require to be done when dealing is happening with so many unregistered suppliers. The next issue with respect to the credits is the cesses and the surcharge. The education cess and the she cess, which was very, very relevant with respect to the erstwhile regime, which came into the current regime, the transition of this education cess and she cess in the initial draft and including the initial law which came, it was allowed to be transitioned and be taken to the next regime. But this retrospective amendment happened so that this amendment basically provided that this cess would not be transitioned to this regime. We have already challenged the restriction placed on the education cess and the she cess. Similarly, with respect to the SWS controversy, there is today a controversy whether these SEIS benefits and MEIS benefits, when these scripts are being used. What are you doing? Go from here. With respect to SEIS and the MEIS, the issue today is that the social welfare surcharge, which is to be paid on these import transactions, and there is a transaction of the MEIS or the SEIS script being used, whether the social welfare surcharge could be knocked off from the value of the script. And the provisions were basically tested before different courts, before different authorities, which led to this restriction. So we have challenged that as well. And there is a decision of the court in one of the cases. Thereafter, there is a circular which has come. But there are lot of these controversies with respect to the SWS. It is certain that this controversy will also be settled by the Apex Court. But as we speak today, there is a circular which denies the benefit with respect to the social welfare surcharge, and that circular needs to be tested in the court as well. Another question, very interesting indeed, which came today before us and was sent to us, was with respect to the subcontractor services. When these services are rendered to the contractor, who is basically a foreign contractor, has presence in India, and has been awarded this contract by some government, Indian or overseas. The issue is with respect to valuation of the services. So for instance, if the main contractor is to basically provide, let's say, rent-a-cab services or hotel services, and such a contractor outsources this work to a subcontractor in India, whether the valuation would be on the entire gross value, or will it be basically restricted only to the extent of the fees which is charged by such a subcontractor? It will completely depend on the nature of the transaction, the contract which has been entered, and how the invoices are being procured. Today, for the first time, the service provider and the service recipient are defined. So which means that if the rent-a-cab service provider or the hotel service provider in this case render services ultimately to the foreign contractor who would have presence in India, depending on the place of provision, which in this case more or less would be in India, because even the foreign contractor has presence in India, would be taxable. So it will be more feasible to take these services or goods or whatever supplies in the name of the foreign contractor, and the subcontractor can basically raise an invoice for its own charge. If that happens contractually and otherwise, then it will be very, very easy for us to substantiate and say that the tax would be levied only on that marginal revenue with respect to the subcontractor. Otherwise, it will be very, very difficult, and this is litigative. So I think from that perspective, it is important that documentation, agreement, invoicing, and all other factors are taken care of. The next issue is with respect to the timing of credit reversal for residential projects. And this also is a question which came to us, and I would want to address that. With respect to the reversal for the residential projects, there is a requirement to reverse the credit to the extent of the unsold inventory. So the question is whether we should reverse that just after receiving the completion certificate, or we should reverse it at the time when these inventory is sold as and when. It is very simple that even if this amount of credit is not reversed just at the time of completion certificate, there is no way that this would be taken for utilization purposes. And hence, if something is there in my books which can never be utilized because it pertains to that inventory, which is with respect to the unsold inventory, so I think it will be more feasible to reverse the credit at that stage when the completion certificate is received, so that there is lesser risk. The other related elements, and because we have also received a lot of queries, we would want to address these queries. Initially, we had thought that we would also spend a lot of time on anti-profiteering and arrest provisions, because these controversies are also related to the credit. But I think on popular demand, we have received requests to take these sessions at length in a separate way. So today I will just touch base on these two important aspects, and then we'll see whether we will be able to take it either at the end or in a separate session. With respect to the credit related controversies, anti-profiteering is a very, very important issue. Section 171 of the CGST Act provides for anti-profiteering provisions which kick in because of two factors. When there is a decrease in the rate of the output tax, or when there is an increase in the quantum of the input tax credit. in both of these situations, if any one of this kicks in or both of these kicks in, then the issue which comes is whether the benefit in terms of the commensurate reduction of prices have gone on to the ultimate consumer. The question is that while these two parameters are important and relevant factors, are these the only factors? Are these the only factors to determine the quantum of profiteering, which basically is nothing but commensurate reduction of prices? And why the words commensurate reduction of prices has been used? Would commensurate means actual reduction of prices to the extent of the quantum of the benefit, or will it take into consideration other factors or not? Interestingly, we have taken, we have argued this anti-profiteering issue for about a dozen of different clients in the real estate sector, in the FMCG sector, in the healthcare, and in the restaurant businesses also. And all of these sectors have different percentages, which means that if there is no straitjacket formula, at least even for a particular sector, there are different ratios which are coming in. Then is there a requirement for a methodology to come in for each of this sector-wise? That's the billion-dollar question, and needs to be answered not only by the authorities, but the fairness will have to be looked into by the courts as well. The other related aspect is with respect to these arrest proceedings. Now, what has happened that there are a lot of cases throughout the country with respect to these circular trading or with respect to bogus invoices. For instance, what is circular trading? A sold goods to B, B sold goods to C, C sold goods to D, and D sold the goods back to A. Now, in that situation, is there a case of fraud? The first question, which is very important, is whether tax has been paid on all of these four transactions. And if GST has been paid on all of these four transactions, then to the extent of GST evasion, there is no case. With respect to money laundering, banking channels, etc., there could be disputes. But the issue thereafter is whether arrests can be made with respect to such transactions, especially in light of the fact that there is no leakage of revenue. There were contradictory decisions of different high courts. Bombay High Court gave us a favorable decision, which we argued at length, and it was more or less in the form of an anticipatory bail, but with a challenge to the provisions as well. The matter was referred and went to the Supreme Court, wherein at least for the Bombay High Court order, there was a favorable thing which continued, because the Apex Court said that there is no need for the Apex Court to intervene as of now at this moment, and the constitution of a three-member judge would now decide the issue. Moving ahead, I think what I would want to do now is to go back and take the viewers to the brand equity judgment. This is a landmark decision and we'll spend some time on it, and just to see that how and who can take the benefit, how we can take the benefit, and so on and so forth. So quickly going into the brand equity judgment, what was the decision? The decision is with respect to those credits which were to be transitioned from the earlier regime to the GST regime. It was not a technical glitch of the system. The assessee in this case that forgot to take the credit within the stipulated time of 90 days. Now what happens? Will the assessee be now required to follow these timelines which were there in the rules, or can the assessee claim it once the deadline has been missed? So the matter went to the court, and the time limit which is specified in Rule 117 came into discussion. The moot point was whether this time limit prescribed is directory or mandatory. This, it is reiterated that this time restriction had come in the rules and not otherwise, which means that the court will have to see different features to determine whether this time limit could mandatorily be imposed. Coming to the conclusion, the court held that the time limit of 90 days prescribed in 117 is directory, and not mandatory, which means that this time limit can exceed and the assessee or the taxpayer can take the credit beyond this period of 90 days. The relevant point of discussion was whether the delegated legislation can prescribe time limit without sanction from the statute. Now, understand that there is a provision of section 140, which basically provides the statutory provisions with respect to these transitional credit and the words which are being used there in any manner. Now, would any manner would also include the time limit was a question. And hence, whether this time limit could be prescribed by the rules, because most of the other time limits, such as the refund time limit, etc., are there in the statutory provisions. So the court held that delegated legislation cannot prescribe time limit without any sanction from the statute. So, which was interesting. And also the court held that discriminatory timelines are violative of Article 14. And why it should happen that for a particular provision, the timeline is there in the rules. For the other provision, the timeline is there in the statute. Can there be different timelines for issues when it relates to the technical disputes, or for those issues where there is no such technology dispute or technical disputes? So in those situations, the court was very, very clear to conclude that when it comes to technical glitches, then the problem is at the end of the government. And the government has been extended time limit, has been extending this time on various occasions, from 90 days to 180 days, 6 months, 1 year, and so on and so forth. But when it comes to those problems which the assessee faced, why should that time limit not be extended even when there is some fault of the assessee? Because that is nothing but also the transitional problem which either the government or the taxpayers have faced. So the court very, very practically referred, and we argued before the court, the provisions of Article 300 capital A of the Constitution. And we said that this credit becomes my right. It becomes my vested right because it was the credit which was to come to me. I have taken and availed that credit in the erstwhile regime, have also disclosed this credit in the returns of the earlier regime. This credit is nothing but my property and comes to me from the Constitution. And hence, Article 300 capital A of the Indian Constitution will have to be looked into to determine this issue of the credit with respect to this transitional phase. The court was very, very inclined to get into those details, but also to find out that what this Article 300A would ultimately lead to. And hence, not only this provision, but also with respect to the directory and mandatory, there were arguments, long arguments, wherein the court relied on the famous decision of Justice Nariman in the case of SCG contracts. In this Supreme Court decision, what was held, that there are basically three very, very relevant conditions which needs to be looked into to determine whether the time limit prescribed is mandatory or directory. And Justice Nariman very, very beautifully passed this decision, which is worth reading, to emphasize that in that instant case of SCG, there was an issue whether the consequence of forfeiture of right has been specifically mentioned. There was an issue, the second issue, whether the court has been specifically denied not to grant an extension, and whether non-extension of further time limit is also prescribed in the statute. So the court held that once all of these three conditions which are there, which I just mentioned, are included in the statute very, very explicitly, then in those situations, the time limit would become mandatory. It would not be possible for the court to extend that, because in any case, that is also coming in a statutory provision. So that formed the basis of even the decision in case of brand equity, wherein the provisions of directory versus mandatory were very importantly used. Now, this decision becomes very, very important from not only the perspective that whether credit is a vested right, but also from the perspective that whether this credit, which is a vested right, could be availed only within the stipulated time which is there in the rules. Now, what could be the balanced approach? Because if that 90 days is not the correct date for availing the credit, how much that period should be? And I asked that question not only to myself, but also in the court to my learned friend and the judges, that why this period is only 90 days? why it is not 90 weeks, why it is not 90 years, why it is not 9 weeks, why it is not 9 years, and how these days have come by way of this provision, which is only 90 days. There has to be some logic, and the authorities today or the lawmakers today cannot just randomly fix any time limit with respect to this credit. And it basically related to a lot of this brainstorming which happened, that if this period is not the correct period, then what should be the period? And hence the reference was taken to the Limitation Act of 1963. The residual clause of Limitation Act of 1963 provided, where nothing is mentioned in that schedule, that the residual period of 3 years with respect to the Limitation Act, which is the residual period, should also be made applicable with respect to these credits. And hence the court concluded by taking a balanced approach that all of this credit which has been missed should be taken by 30th of June 2020. The beautiful part of the decision was that the benefit was not restricted to the petitioners, which means that the benefit could be extended to anybody in the country who would have missed that credit. And that opened the Pandora box. The respondents were specifically asked, and it happened by way of a virtual hearing over a video conferencing, wherein I still remember that the respondents were asked to publicize the judgment widely. It was expressly told to them that they should extend this benefit to all of those taxpayers who have missed this deadline, so that all of these taxpayers in this situation of economic slowdown get that benefit. So from that perspective, while it was a very, very fantastic decision, but I think there are certain challenges to this decision as well now as we speak because of the retrospective amendment. And we will come to that in a while. But before going to that, I think the real question now is that who can take the benefit of this decision? So of course, the petitioners can take the benefit of this decision. The decision is of Delhi High Court. Can the people out of the jurisdiction of Delhi High Court can also take the benefit? There are contradictory decisions in some states such as Bombay. So what happens to those taxpayers who are there in the Bombay jurisdiction? So how I would want to divide this into three parts. All of those taxpayers who are in the jurisdiction of Delhi High Court can obviously take the decision, can take the benefit of this decision of the Delhi High Court. The second category would be those people who are outside the state of Delhi High Court jurisdiction, but are also outside the jurisdiction of those courts where there are negative orders. They can also basically rely on the decision of the Delhi High Court because one of the respondents is also Union of India. Now, Union of India cannot only give the benefit to the taxpayers only in a particular state. So even those people should get the benefit. Now, the third question is what happens to those states where there is a negative decision. The petitioner, of course, will have to move on to the Supreme Court, and at that junction can basically rely on this decision of the brand equity. But others who have not got any order from these courts where already there is a negative order can rely on this decision and go to the authorities. Now, how can they take the benefit? Relying on the decision of the Delhi High Court, they could have taken the benefit by filing a manual application if online is not permissible, then writing corresponding letters to them, and then if there is no action, then maybe going to the writ court. Then the question which now arises is that with respect to this retrospective amendment which has come a couple of days back, the amendment today basically provides that the relevant provisions of section 140 would be amended in such a way so that the time limit prescription power is being provided in the statute itself by reference to the rules, which means today as we speak, there is a retrospective amendment which has come in after the decision of the Delhi High Court, and it has come by way of a notification just a couple of days back. Now, what is the implication today as we speak with a retrospective amendment? The implication today is that, of course, this retrospective amendment has become a law. The question is, whether this can be challenged. There is a clear need that retrospective amendment needs to be challenged in the days ahead. Retrospective amendment can come only in rarest of rare cases. Retrospective amendment cannot come by a natural consequence of a court's order. In lot of decisions which we have today, retrospective amendments become part of the discussion or becomes relevant only in situations wherein there is some flaw which has happened or there is an abusive tax planning. So if I were to summarize this, correcting any drafting flaw could be one of the reasons for a retrospective amendment. If some clarification need to come in the act which clarifies the position and does not expand the scope of taxability, could come by way of retrospective amendment. If there are evident cases of abusive tax planning, then in those cases, retrospective amendment can come. But these have to be rarest of rare cases. And hence, in a case where the court has held the provision to be unconstitutional and the retrospective amendment comes, then it clearly falls as a usurpation of judicial power. Now, why I want to say that? Because after the court order, if there is a retrospective amendment which happens, then the entire judicial power goes for a toss. The decision of the court goes for the toss. And the retrospective amendment basically becomes a showstopper. In that perspective, I think the retrospective amendment will also have to cross the constitutional barrier of validity. And hence, it is very, very important that at right stage, this is challenged before the court as well. While these petitions would now go with the retrospective amendment to the Supreme Court, of course, the retrospectivity will be tested before the Supreme Court. But in case any of these taxpayers would want to take the benefit in the days ahead till 30th of June or have already filed an application for this vested right of credit, they could also basically go to the court to challenge the retrospective part. If this gets challenged and admitted, then I think the taxpayers will be able to get that benefit because the limited window of 30th of June is there and urgency can be mentioned as well. Interestingly, in this decision of brand equity, the moot point before the court was whether to held rule 117 as ultra vires or basically read down the provisions. The court decided that they would not go into the constitutional validity of this provision of timeline, but would read it down in such a way so that the benefit gets extended. And the benefit gets extended not only to the petitioner, but also to a lot of those thousands of taxpayers who would have missed taking this credit because of non-technical glitches. There are a lot of questions which have been posed by the viewers with respect to whether the authorities or the revenue would go and file an SLP before the Supreme Court. And if I look back last 2 years, the Union of India and other respondents after losing these important matters have always gone ahead to the Apex Court. It looks very evident that the matter will finally be decided by the Supreme Court. Last but not the least is with respect to the contradictory decisions which are there. And there are contradictory decisions with respect to the brand equity judgment. Also, there is a decision of Bombay High Court which is there in case of NELCO. And how I would want to summarize this in 5 bullets is that, and why NELCO decision has not addressed few of those important aspects which has been addressed by brand equity, is that with respect to the Eicher Motors. Now, Eicher Motors has been taken on record by both the courts, but Bombay High Court distinguished Eicher Motors case by saying that Eicher Motor dealt with lapse of credit and not transition of credit. The Bombay High Court probably ignored that whether it's the case of lapsing of credit or transition of credit, that will not make any difference to the life, because the real test is with respect to whether it is a vested right and whether the vested right could be availed only with respect to the stipulated timeline in the delegated legislation. So that was completely missed by Bombay High Court, and hence going against Eicher Motor was not a good thing to be done. With highest respect to the Bombay High Court, there were 4 other points as well with respect to, such as Senvet was conditional. It was held by Bombay High Court and it cannot be converted into something unconditional. Now, that argument also has a flaw, because this in fact remained a condition. There are specific conditions for both the credits in the erstwhile regime or in the current regime. The only situation which now differs is with respect to the timing of this credit. And hence, it cannot be said that it cannot be converted into something unconditional. The only condition with respect to the time was to be tested. The other argument taken into consideration by Bombay High Court was that time limit is essential to facilitate economic planning. Now remember, these credits are transitional credits. The government always had the data that how much of this transitional credit would come into the GST regime. Now, the fact that time limit is essential to facilitate economic planning is a completely flawed argument, because from that perspective, the government always had the data and it would come in any case into the main GST regime credit flow, because that was always the objective of even the GST implementation. Transition provisions are not available in perpetuity was another point considered by the Bombay High Court, which has been very pragmatically addressed by Delhi High Court by fixing time limit of 3 years by referring to the residual clause of the Limitation Act. So I think the balanced approach of fixing the time limit of 3 years, while I agree that this transition cannot happen in perpetuity, but I think relying on the provisions of the Limitation Act was very, very pragmatic and helped the industry at large and resolved the issue to a very, very large extent. But this retrospective amendment which has come has now become a spoil sport. So in all of these favorable decisions, the Bombay High Court held that the courts exercised equity jurisdiction. And I completely believe that equity jurisdiction becomes very, very relevant to be followed, because following the principles of fairness has been the objective of the courts. I think law comes after logic, fairness comes much before that. So from that perspective, if the equity jurisdiction of the courts have been used in all of these transitional credit decisions, I think that's the right approach. That cannot become a reason for the courts to deviate from the fact that this remains my vested right. So from that perspective, I think with highest respect to the Bombay High Court, the decision has certain flaws. And I think both of these will travel to the Supreme Court and ultimately be decided by the Apex Court. Now, another point which I want to basically highlight is that what are those writs on which the brand equity judgment would have a lot of impact. So we spoke about the 12-month transition restriction on goods which were held in stock. I think from that, from the perspective of the vested right, the writ petitions with respect to the transition of this credit with respect to the limited period of a 12-month stock would also have a major impact, because if the court has held that it's a vested right, that credit is my vested right, and it becomes part of my property by virtue of Article 300 capital A of the Indian Constitution, I think the restriction of 12 months will also have to be tested on those grounds. Then we have, there is a recent decision in case of Bharti Airtel, wherein rectification of form GSTR 3B was to be done only in the month of filing. From that perspective also, I think this decision of the Delhi High Court will have a lot of relevance. Transition of SENVET credit pertaining to CESS, we mentioned about those education CESS, secondary higher education CESS, restrictions on social welfare surcharge being debited to the scripts. I think with respect to all of those issues also, this brand equity judgment, the ratio decidendi of this decision would be used in different ways, and based on the principles of stare decisis, etc., there would be a lot of benefits which would come to these existing writs in different, these pending writs in different courts. Two very important aspects are with respect to section 140 subsection 5 and section 142 subsection 9B. Now, what happens in section 140 subsection 5? Erstwhile tax invoices were to be recorded within a period of 30 days from the implementation of the GST. Now, if those erstwhile tax invoices were not recorded within 30 days, then the credit would lapse as per the statutory provision of section 140 subsection 5. The brand equity judgment opens the Pandora box and says that even if those erstwhile tax invoices were not recorded within the stipulated time period of 30 days, today, after almost 3 years thereafter, also credit can be taken by the taxpayers. So I think there is need to look into those invoices which were probably not recorded on time and credit may have been missed onto those invoices. And it becomes important for us to take into consideration those important invoices for credit purposes. Another provision with respect to 142 subsection 9b is with respect to erstwhile returns not revised. So in case those erstwhile returns were not revised within the stipulated time, the resulting refund would have been denied. Now, there was a requirement that the erstwhile returns will have to be revised, and only based on the revision of those returns, you would get the refund if it is eligible to you. In this situation also, the provision, the decision of brand equity would come into play, and this could be used to our advantage. Another requirement which is there in the credit is with respect to the requirement to pay vendors within 6 months. So if I have procured certain supplies and I have not paid to the vendor within 6 months, then there is a requirement to reverse the credit. Whether that would be applicable now in light of this brand equity decision in case of default, I'm not saying we should deliberately do that, but in case that has been missed, then can the decision of the brand equity would come to the benefit is also a point which cannot be ignored. Moving on to the next slide, now that we have covered most of the aspects with respect to the credits and different questions also, I would quickly take into the taxation of intermediaries. There is only one slide, we'll keep it short, but if there'll be any questions related to intermediaries, then we would address for sure. Now, the place of supply of these intermediaries have been challenged by us in different courts. What we are saying is that section 13.8b specifies the place of provision for intermediary services to be based on the location where the service provider is. So for instance, if the service provider is in the state of Maharashtra, the service recipient is, let's say, in the US, and the services are rendered by the Indian intermediary with respect to the goods for these procurement of these orders, etc. And the goods would ultimately move to either, let's say, Dubai or to India. The question is that whether this intermediary would be required to pay tax based on the place of supply. Now, the rule says is that the place of supply would be the place where the service provider is. So when the services are being rendered by the intermediaries, they would become taxable based on the place of supply. What we are basically saying is that these services are rendered to someone who's situated outside of India. The place of consumption is outside of India because the services are in any case used by the foreign service receiver who's situated outside of India, who gets the benefit of these services. And the consumption also happens based on the privity of contract for the services and are not dependent on the movement of goods. So we have challenged the provisions of the place of provision for this intermediary. And mind you, these are statutory provisions which have been challenged. It is absolutely difficult to challenge the statutory provisions and when it comes to a lot of these policy decisions. The matter has already been finally heard by Gujarat High Court and is pending in several other courts where we are arguing. But let's see what the decision comes. But whether the decision is positive or negative, one thing what I can definitely promise you today is that the order would be worth reading. It would be a detailed order because the argument continued for almost 10 days, over the period of 10 different days. And it was beautifully argued to not only emphasize on different aspects of the Indian constitution, but also different statutory provisions which are there in India, and a lot of emphasis on the foreign laws. There is already a recommendation from the Rajya Sabha Select Committee, the Parliamentary Standing Committee report is there, and there is a TRU circular, which basically all want to give the benefit to these service providers, but ultimately nothing has come into law. What has come into law is that the place of consumption of these goods would determine whether the benefit to the Indian service provider would be given or not. For instance, if the consumption of those ultimate movement of good goes into India, then the benefit comes. But if those goods move from the US to Dubai, then that would not. So that is very, very relevant today. And it was highlighted before the court that this is the first time in the GST regime, as compared to the earlier service tax regime, that the definition of the service provider and the service recipient have been defined. Now, when we have the clear definition of who the service provider is, who the service recipient is, and it is very clear that in case of intermediaries, the services are received by the person situated outside of India. Money is received in convertible foreign exchange. The benefit is also received by the person who is situated outside of India. Then all of those benefits which are given to all other service providers situated in India, such as the investment advisory services, these benefits should also be given to the Indian intermediaries. And hence, default rule, which means that the place of the recipient of the services comes and becomes more relevant. An example was provided to the court that, for instance, if an investment advisory service provider is situated in India and the person to whom the services are being rendered is situated in New York, and based on the advice of the service provider in India, the investor either invest on the London Stock Exchange or Bombay Stock Exchange should not have any relevance. The services ultimately are being received by the person situated outside of India. Driving that analogy to the intermediaries, even in this case, the services are ultimately being consumed or the benefit of those services has been received by the person situated outside of India. And hence, the moot point remains whether the place of provision could in this situation be in India. And that's the entire challenge to the controversy. It will be interesting in the days ahead to see that how courts view this viewpoint and what decision comes in the near future. So that's all from my side, and I am more than happy to for the questions, and you can either post the questions or one by one probably ask me the questions. I'll be more than happy to address these questions.
So can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sir, actually, we have a club also. Hello. Sir, I'm from Tata Tinplate. Actually, we have a club also, and employee taking the membership from the club, whether that membership fees is charged for GST. And also, I want to like to know the other services which are providing to the member is also applicable for GST or not.
So basically, what I understand is that you have members of the club, and yes, those sir. members of the club pay the membership fee, and that membership fee, whether that is subject to tax or not, is your question, right?
Yes, sir.
So today, as we speak, there is a Supreme Court decision on that regard. There is a Calcutta High Court decision in that regard. But those decisions are with respect to the erstwhile regime. Today, as we speak, we have an advanced ruling for Rotary Club. And this is my personal view, that for the service to become taxable, there should be a flow of consideration from one person to another. Now, when we talk about the club and the members of these clubs, the question is that these members are integral part of those clubs. So is this a case of rendition of service to oneself? That's the argument which has been taken in different forums. So from the perspective of even the GST, that argument will hold very relevant. But what I suggest is that if you have a lot of money at stake, it will be important for you to obtain advanced ruling. We have basically taken this matter not only to the advanced ruling authorities, but also thought of knocking the doors of the court. But sometimes what happens is that you will have to do economic analysis of the issue also. And also keep in mind that these advanced ruling authorities are sometimes pro revenue. So it will completely depend, my friend, that in which state you are. So if you are in a, and I don't want to on this webinar tell you that what would be the decision if you are in a particular state, but I think you will have to do that due diligence in terms of the money involved, in terms of where this club or the premise is, so that what is your jurisdictional High Court or the AAR. So it would not make any benefit for you to go to the AAR if you are in a particular state. The decision will be negative. Doesn't make sense. But yes, at the same time, you will have to document everything very well, so that if the tax demand comes at a later stage, that is very, very clear that these services are basically rendered to yourself. So basically, if you were to ask me, in terms of the membership fee, etc., is nothing but a contribution or a revenue. So basically, what happens when two parties come and pool in the resources? What happens when there is a split between the cost? These transactions, even under the GST regime, should ideally not be subject to tax. And hence, my answer predominantly and fairly to you would be that these should not be subject to tax.
Mr. Rastogi?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have another question. Are you finished?
Yeah, I'm finished.
Yeah, can I ask you a question? It's not relevant to what case law we discussed today, but it's relevant to one of
no
our
problem.
Rates. Yeah,
no problem.
My question
Mr.
is,
tell me.
Yeah, my question is, in January, there was a decision of Mohit Minerals versus Union of India,
yeah,
wherein it's a Gujarat High Court decision in case of
yeah.
the rate, wherein they have said that the RCM on freight is unconstitutional levy.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so post that judgment, do we,
yeah.
what is the fate of various writ petitions in different other high courts? And is few assessees who are not actually able to claim that credit and utilize it, because you know that the trading margin is very low. And most of the manufacturing
yeah.
companies who have paid that RCM would have utilized it, but trading companies are not able to utilize it. And it's still showing a credit amount, a huge amount. So is there a way out that that can be claimed as a refund?
Okay. Nice question. Let me first of all apprise you that we are arguing more than a dozen of writs on ocean freight in different courts. The first writ petition which was filed on ocean freight was by us, and it was not only for the GST regime, but was for the service tax regime. We had challenged the levy of ocean freight even with respect to the service tax applicability, which came only for a few months. But still we went ahead in Bombay High Court, and that was the first writ petition on ocean freight. Fortunately or unfortunately, Bombay High Court, where we are arguing various writs, a dozen of writs on ocean freight, the rule has been issued, which means that these have been admitted, but the answer with respect to the constitutionality of these have not been decided. So which means, to answer with respect to the status, Bombay High Court rule issued, now the matter will be decided in 10 years, 5 years, 6 years, whatever, right? Gujarat High Court also, where this order was there with respect to this ocean freight, there were writs which we were also arguing. And of course, the court is very clear to held that this is unconstitutional. So that's the status. Similarly, if you see petitions which we are arguing in Punjab and Haryana High Court and Delhi High Court, there is no decision so far. There is no interim order also which is there. Now, in such a situation, what happens? The law of the land today is that this provision with respect to the ocean freight is unconstitutional. Now, what is the repercussion when the court held a particular provision to be ultra vires? Now, in this case, what has happened is that if even one single court held that the provision is ultra vires, then it becomes ultra vires for the entire country. The situation is different when one high court differs from the other high court. So, for instance, if there would have been a contradictory decision between the Gujarat High Court and Bombay High Court, then it would have been case of JCB versus Philco, right, for transitional credit of 1 year. But here, because for ocean freight, there is only one decision of Gujarat High Court, and Gujarat High Court has very specifically held this provision to be unconstitutional. Everybody in the country can take the benefit of this decision of Gujarat High Court to stop paying the tax unless and until there is a stay on the Gujarat High Court decision. As we speak, there is no stay on the Gujarat High Court decision, which means that the law, as we speak, is very clear that this taxability is unconstitutional. And because the YDs were challenged and which has been decided by the court. So I think a lot of these retailers, which you mentioned, who have paid it under the reverse charge, should take benefit of this, write appropriately to this jurisdictional tax office, take credit to the extent of that, and take benefit of this unless and until there is a stay. If they can probably keep that amount as unutilized and as only availed, but not utilized, that would help them in case there is a negative order. But yes, this benefit should come to them. In any case, see, what will happen now is that the authority, that the revenue will file an SLP against this. There is no doubt. And most of these matters would get transferred to Supreme Court to be ultimately and finally decided by the Apex Court. But having said that, till that time, the right of the SSC legally is very clear that they can take the benefit of Gujarat High Court decision because it has clearly held on constitutionality.
So, Rastogi, I have a question.
Amit. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yeah.
My question is specifically about is it worthwhile exploring going to a court to challenge the applicability of reverse charge mechanism on sponsorship services? Because if you can imagine, the entire input credit is blocked and we have been knocking, making representations, but people see the merit at the highest level. They say you have a very sympathetic case, but unless the council takes up, we cannot do anything. So do you recommend going to the court and knocking at the court's door? Because 18% cost escalation is a huge, huge impact.
Mahesh, I think you have raised a very, very fundamental point today. The objective of GST is that there should not be any tax cascading. There should be seamless flow of credit. This question came to me from a small association, Merit Publishers Association, who were paying tax for the authors under the reverse charge. And imagine books are free, books are tax exempt. Now, if books are tax exempt and the reverse charge mechanism becomes applicable on the services procured from the authors, and these could be small authors also, who would not cross the threshold of 20 lakhs or whatever, whatever. There is a clear case of trading. Then these published to me with respect to three issues. With respect to those procurements from unregistered dealers, for which we went to the, they have got the relief from the GST Council, because GST Council also realized that that was a very, very bad provision to be implemented. The second was with respect to this author. We went to the court, we got the benefit, from the GST Council, not from the court. Matter is still sub judice before Delhi High Court, but there is already a benefit with respect to these authors, wherein there is an option which has come of forward charge. Now, if the option of forward charge comes, then substantially the problem ends, because 95% of the authors will have royalty of less than 20 lakhs. So that problem goes. So while I would respect, the way the GST Council has worked. In fact, when I still remember, Mr. Arun Jaitley had written the foreword of my books. We had huge discussion with him at that point of time, and I personally work very closely with the Finance Minister office. But the problem today is that these are smaller issues. Today, government has a lot of bigger issues, bigger problems. And hence, while it is the right way to go by filing a representation to the North Block, I doubt anything would work. So I think knocking the doors of the court based on fairness, equity, if there is genuinely a case of tax cascading or fairness, I think it will be fair. And my experience is that GST Council basically puts a thought on paper once the matter goes to the court. Otherwise, there are thousands of representations which are lying in the North Block. Thank you, Mahesh.
Hi, Abhishek. This is Vineet here.
Yeah, Vineet.
So for the intermediary services provided outside India, now considering the place of supply, the location of intermediary would be the deciding factor, and the place of supply would be in India, as in where the location of intermediary is there. So what will be the tax that needs to be charged, CNS or IGST in this case?
Right. So basically, what the provision says. The provision says that the place of provision is the place where the service provider is, right? Now, service receiver is outside that state for sure. So in that case, in such a situation, the service receiver is not within the state and service provider is, so which means that the service provider and service recipient are not in the same state. So this cannot be a situation of intrastate services. Now, these are held to be interstate services and hence IGST should be levied. But my point is that no tax should be levied. That's what I'm arguing before the court. But if you were to idly see that, the service provider and service recipient are not in the same state and hence that intrastate, which means SGST and CGST cannot be made applicable. But the question, but the point remains is that whether there should be tax at all. And my conclusion is that there should not be tax at all on this transaction because at the very first instance, the place of provision, which is basically in the state where the service provider is wrong. So from that perspective, Vineet, tax should not be payable at all. And you can just wait for a couple of weeks to get this order.
Thank you, Abhishek. Thank you.
Sir, this is Vijay Gopal.
Yeah, Vijay.
Sir, the question that I have is slightly different from the discussion here. Actually, we are a EPC-based organization and wherein we have executed a couple of contracts to the government also. So these contracts were entered in the pre-GST regime and in the post-GST regime
can
also.
Can you please repeat that?
Yeah, we are basically an EPC-based organization wherein we have entered few agreements, EPC-based organization. Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible, Vijayji.
Yeah. So we have entered into certain agreements under the pre-GST scenario with some of our government clients. And the major part of the contract is getting executed in the GST scenario also. So now, as per the transitional provisions and other things, as per the anti-profiteering provisions also, we have passed on the benefit of the erstwhile taxes to the government. I mean, we have submitted our proposal for passing on that one. And we are requesting the government to reimburse the additional GST. Because our being water projects under service tax, it was exempted. Now 12% it was levied. So, but government has been reluctant and they have been lingering the issue for the past 3 years. And now they say that it is no more payable because in the opinion of the commercial taxes department, this amount is not payable. So just I would like to know in the country, in various states, how are the contractors dealing with this kind of situation? Whether any writ petitions have been filed, whether any favorable decisions are there?
So on this particular issue, there is no writ petition. The writ petitions on anti-profiteering issue is with respect to the quantum which has been challenged and when these matters have gone to NA, etc. The issue which is there in your case is with respect to the tax which has now become payable in the current regime, which was not payable earlier. Now, what is to be done in this case is there has to be an impact on the contract price also. So for instance, if in the earlier regime, the consideration was 100 rupees and there was no output tax, then also the credits were becoming a cost to you. Now, in this regime, now if there is a 5% tax on these transactions, you can't recover 100 plus 5 from the from your customer because that 5 is actually not paid by you completely. And you would, let's say, get the credit to the extent of 1 rupee, which was a tax cascading in the earlier regime. So I think if you give them those numbers, and those calculations, Vijay, then I think you will be able to better explain them that you are not basically recovering entire 5 from them now. You are recovering maybe 4 or 4.5 and you can actually share your returns to say that this is the credit which has been utilized to offset the demand of 5 while discharging that liability. So from that perspective, I think you can reach out to them with numbers and explain them that you are only asking for the differential. And that will also help you in case there are any inquiries from the anti-profiteering authorities.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, basically we are an EPC contractor, but our realization of payments has been taken 90 to 120 days. So how to file our GSTR 3B within the stipulated time? Or any other option?
So your issue is that the payment is being made in 90 to 120 days, right?
Okay. Yes, sir.
If that is the issue, then in any case, you can take the credit based on the based on the invoices. The only issue which remains is that within 6 months you have to pay to the vendor. If you're not paying to the vendor, then there is a problem.
We are actually basically you are EPC contractor and all the funders have
okay. Okay. I'm sorry. So basically what you mean to say is that you are a service provider and your customer pays to you within 90 to 180, 120 days. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. So you become out of pocket with respect to the payment, because what happens is that you raise your invoice and you receive the payment only after 90 to 120 days, but you have to discharge your tax liability in the subsequent month.
Yes, sir.
So I think the only way out there is that you negotiate in terms of the contract price. Payment terms and the contract price. So you will have to basically say that if you have to pay me at this price or at this rate, then the payment terms will have to shift. That's the only way. And then take an indemnity from them that if they don't pay you after 90 to 120 days, contractually they will be liable to pay at least with respect to the taxes. For sure with interest.
But our contract is, all contractor has been awarded from state governments, which has funded by central government schemes.
I know. See, that's the problem. And the bigger problem in the GST regime is that what happens that if you don't even receive the payment in 90 to 120 days, if it becomes a bad debt, then in any case, at the time of raising the invoice, you have to discharge your tax liability. That's the bigger problem. So I'm saying you are still receiving payment in 90 to 120 days. Now imagine a situation where you would not receive payment even within 90 to 120 days. Then what would happen in those cases? You would be completely out of pocket. So I think even if these contracts are with the state government or the central government, negotiation by explaining them the hardship which you have is the relevant thing. These would be all running contracts, old contracts getting converted into the new contracts for newer assignments. So I think from that perspective, negotiation is the only way out. Unless and until you want to go to the court and challenge the point of taxation of payment of these taxes by saying that how can I pay for that consideration which I have not received, and we should go to the earlier position of taxes which was there in the service tax, that you would pay tax at the time of the receipt of the consideration.
Yes.
Unless and until you would want to do that, there is no other way out, my friend. I'm sorry, Vijayji, but that's what it is.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I think Mr. Ravi wants to ask a question. I think Mr. Ravi wants to ask, and Nilesh, they have posted on the chat box. Who wants to go next?
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, I am Supit. Actually, I have one doubt that Bharti Airtel case, we can revise the 3B returns.
Yeah.
My
dear friend, the only problem is that while you can revise it in that month now, Bharti Airtel, the only problem is that that benefit is qua the petitioner. You can't take the benefit of that decision of the Delhi High Court to your benefit because you are not there in the court. You will have to immediately file a writ petition in the court, take the benefit of Bharti Airtel decision. Sorry, okay. I didn't get your name, please.
Supreet.
Sorry?
Supreet.
Supreet.
Ah, yes.
Supreet. So I think what you will have to do is, you will have to take the benefit of the Bharti Airtel decision to your benefit and move immediately to the court. If you have a registered office in Delhi High Court, the best thing would be to approach Delhi High Court, because there you will get the benefit immediately. and then you can take the benefit of that because it's decided by Delhi High Court. And then you can take that benefit. Yeah, because the benefit is qua the petitioner, not as a general rule.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So, sir, we have already filed a writ petition for our transactional credit, and at the Bombay High Court, and Bombay High Court has directed us to withdraw the petition with a condition that we need to approach GST Council. Now, we have already written to GST Council, and almost now 6 months have gone. And in between, this COVID situation has come in. So we have not received any firm reply from GST Council. Simultaneously, we tried to approach the nodal officer also. But the nodal officer said that without any written thing from GST Council, we will not be able to do anything much on it. So how do we go about this? Sir, what would be your...
Sorry, I didn't get your name, please.
My name is Lakshmi Khan.
Lakshmi?
Lakshmikant.
Yeah. Mr. Lakshmikant, this is not surprising to me if Bombay High Court has asked you to withdraw the writ petition, first of all. But the related and relevant point is that if you have already gone after withdrawal of that writ to the GST Council and GST Council has not acted on that for 6 months, there is a cause of action now that you can go to the Bombay High Court again to knock the doors. And probably, I don't know, if you would have got this order some 9 months, 10 months back, the situation was very different in terms of the constitution of the benches also. Maybe, you know, today you could go to the court with urgency and say that I am facing this problem. That is one. Secondly, you can also go to the court and mention about the brand equity decision, which is there in your favor. And of course, the inaction of the GST Council. So I think from all of these perspectives, you can again go to the court and get the benefit to the court, because that would be the speedier thing to do.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, again, I have one more doubt that now recently Ministry of Home Affairs issued a notification that one health insurance is mandatory for all employees. So can we avail the credit on ITC? And one more thing, as per labor law, food is above 250 employees. Food is mandatory for that canteen facilities. So can we avail the ITC against that food, sir?
See, understand with respect to the block credits. Any expenditure which is required in the course or furtherance of my business is relevant and should come to my credit pool. In spite of the fact that there could be certain restrictions under Section 17, would not mean that there are restrictions actually which should be taken. So now what happens with respect to these canteen services and all, in all of those cases where these are personal use or consumption is there, then that's a separate thing. But in this case, what is to be seen is the wording of Section 16(1) also, which says used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of business. So used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of business. So I think both the credits, the question which you have asked, are in any case in the course or furtherance of business, and are, of course, used for business purposes. It is not like personal membership of a club which is being given and is being used as a personal consumption. So from that perspective, I think the credit should be allowed in both of these cases.
Is there any, like, for employees, we are providing a food benefit, lunch, all those things. We need to raise we need to show it as an outward supply also, or directly we can avail the ITC credit?
No, so generally how the transactions happen is that there would be an outdoor caterer. For example, if he's charging 40 rupees per plate, you would recover 20 rupees from the employee, right? That's what you would do.
No, we are not recovering any amount from employees. Free of cost we are providing.
But if you're providing,
we are raising invoice also in our transaction. We are raising invoice like B2C invoices.
No, if you are not charging any money to the employee, then there is no question of raising an invoice. So what I understand is that there is an outdoor service caterer or service provider who's there, who's coming and cooking food, etc. And you are serving this food to your employees, you are not recovering any amount from them. If you are not recovering any amount from them, then there is no need of raising an invoice or anything on the employee. The only requirement now is that the person who is providing these catering services is actually providing this catering service to you and not to the employees. So he will have to raise an invoice on you so that you take the benefit of credit. That's all, sir.
Sir, here, I am Vijay Gopal here, relating to this only. Section 17.5 starts with notwithstanding anything contained in section 16.1. So then in such case, can we say that for this medical insurance for the employees and food consumed by the employees, can we take the logic of that 16.1 where it is used for the purpose of business?
You have raised actually a very, very valid point. The non-obstant clause, which is used in 17.5, has to be read harmoniously not only with 16.1, but also with the object and the intent of GST. Now, if you see the writ petitions, which I am arguing on section 17.5C, 17.5D, and 17.5H, are all with respect to these credits, which are otherwise restricted in the Act. Now, what we have done is, we have basically challenged the provision of the Act per se. Now, what I'm trying to say is that if you read the law as it is, then you won't get the benefit at all. Then, you know, of course, you will have to read the law the way it is there in the statute. But to get the benefit, you will have to basically challenge the law. Now, if we specifically read section 17.5, it says notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1 of section 16 and subsection 1 of section 18, input tax credit should not be available in respect of the following, namely, and then it goes. Now, if you, of course, because it's overriding 16.1 and 16.1 says entitled to take credit of input tax charge on both to him, which are used or intended to be used in the course of furtherance of his business. Now, what also happens is that what is the objective of GST? Is the objective of GST very clear that there should not be any tax cascading, which will come into play while the matter is decided based on fairness before the courts? And that's why these petitions go into those angles to challenge that. It is not only the provisions of only section 16.1 which will come into play. Now, what will happen is that while 17.5 has used the non-obstant clause and has an overriding effect on 16.1, 16.1 in general provides the principles when this can be used. Now, what will happen is while there is an overriding clause over 16.1, 16.1 is more closer to following the objectives of GST, which are not being followed by coming and going to 17.5. And hence defeats the purpose of the GST implementation based on not only the tax cascading effect, but also for seamless credits and the objectives of GST. So if you want to read law as it is, the benefit will not be available. But if you have to challenge the provision per se to say that that is unconstitutional, then there is a point that has to be basically proven.
Hello.
Yeah.
So this is Ravi Gupta. Can I ask a question now?
Yeah, Mr. Ravi. Please go ahead.
Sir, just a small thing. In our company, Hindustan Copper Limited, we have an inverted duty structure in our manufacturing. That is in the sense when we manufacture copper concentrate, the inputs which we are getting is at around 18% and the output which moves out is 5%. And especially
in mining. Case of inverted duty structure.
That's right, sir. And especially in mining, what is happening is we use a lot of services. Huge services are used to take out mineral from Mother Earth.
Yeah.
Now, what's happening is this, in this inverted duty structure, refund of services is not allowed. It has been introduced from retrospective effect. So what do we do? We are in an absolute fix. Lots of duties getting accumulated. And over and above, sir, another small thing, over and above, we are going over a huge expansion plan.
Yeah.
Hello? So under the expansion plan, we are again expending a lot of duty on capital inputs, on capital services. So this is also getting accumulated. So a huge amount has got accumulated. Sir, can you tell us a way out, how to go about this?
I have already prepared a writ petition issue.
Sir.
On inverted duty structure where there's a restriction with respect to the services.
Right,
it's
sir.
Just that my client doesn't want to go to Allahabad High Court. And we are now basically testing whether we can probably wait for some time or file the petition in Allahabad High Court, because ultimately the matter will be decided by the Supreme Court only.
Yeah.
So maybe we could file in Allahabad and get it transferred. But that will be too late for you to wait. Now, if you see the provisions of Section 54.3, there is no restriction with respect to services in the statutory provisions.
Right.
There is restriction only in the rules. Now, I will tell you why and how.
Yes,
if you see Section 54.3, it says subject to the provisions of subsection 10, a registered person may claim refund of any unutilized input tax credit.
Yeah.
It says unutilized input tax credit at the end of any tax period.
Yeah.
And then it says provided that no refund of unutilized tax credit shall be allowed in cases other than. And I will go to two, which is relevant for you. Where the credit has accumulated on account of the rate of inputs.
Yeah.
On the rate of inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies.
Yeah.
Right. And I will pause there. Now, basically, what this proviso says is that inverted duty structure benefit can be taken when the rate of inputs is more than the rate of output. But it does not say that the restriction has to be with respect to the input services or capital goods.
Yes, sir.
Which is coming only in the rules. Now, rules have gone beyond the statute.
Yeah.
It is very interesting. I will repeat for the sake of repetition. I will repeat.
Yes,
if you see the proviso, it says where the credit has accumulated on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies.
Yeah.
And then it creates an exception for nil rate and exempted. I will not go into that.
Okay, sir.
Right. Except supplies of goods or services or both as may be notified. I will not even go to that.
Yeah.
I will pause where I paused before. And it says where the credit has accumulated on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supply, that's where it pauses.
Yes.
So basically it says that under this circumstance, inverted duty structure benefit would be given under 54.3. But nowhere in the statute it says that the benefit has to come only with respect to the services.
Mr. Rastogi,
nowhere
please,
it says that, even with
Mr.
respect
Rastogi,
to capital
please see section 259.
Yeah. Yeah.
That defines what is input.
Section 2.
59.
Yeah.
That defines what is input.
Right.
That clearly talks about goods only.
Sir, we will also have to see 263. That what is input tax credit? And 263 will have to be also read with 262. What is input tax? And what 54.3 says is unutilized input tax credit. And then it says, in the provision it says, on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher. So what I'm trying to conclude is that unutilized input tax credit is nothing but the input tax credit on input which has been defined to mean as the credit of input tax.
Okay,
input
for
tax
it's stretching the logic too far. Okay, go ahead, please.
So basically, what I'm trying to say is that unutilized input tax credit is the phrase which is used. Input tax credit is defined in 263 to mean the credit of input tax, input tax is defined under 262 to lay down A to E. So what I and I appreciate that what you are saying is input means which is being defined in 259. I have no quarrel there, because 54(3) uses unutilized input tax credit, and I am satisfying input tax credit to mean everything, because A to E is inclusive. But if you see the portion before the inclusive, what means it says tax charged on any supply of goods or services, so which gets covered. Now what I want to explain to Mr. Ravi is that the benefit which is given under the inverted duty structure, section 54(3), it says that the benefit will be extended in which situation. The statutory provision talks only about that. The statutory provision says that the benefit gets extended in a situation wherein the rate of the inputs is more than the rate of the output. And that has been specifically used in the section. It says where the credit has accumulated. Now, it is basically providing that when the benefit of inverted duty structure or the benefit of refund under 54(3) can be taken. And it says where the credit has accumulated on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies. Now, which is the situation which Mr. Ravi has highlighted, that's exactly what the situation is. Now, the situation is that if we go ahead with respect to implementation of this by applying the formula net ITC and so on and so forth, there is that formula which excludes the benefit of the input services. Now, what I want to conclude is that the delegated legislation has gone beyond the statutory provisions by wrongfully reading the statutory provisions, which basically provides an instance when that inverted duty structure refund will kick in, but which does not mean that the benefit of the input services will have to be excluded from that. That's what my conclusion is. And I think the best way would be to approach the court and get the benefit. And this is a fair issue which needs to be addressed. Mr. Ravi, is located in which state? I can't hear you, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself.
Yeah. Basically, these mines are located in the state of Madhya Pradesh as well as in the state of Rajasthan.
So Rajasthan is a good court. Even Madhya Pradesh is a good court.
Okay.
Has been addressing these important issues. And I have argued a couple of very, very important, interesting issues before Rajasthan High Court. Rajasthan High Court could provide you an interim relief also.
Okay.
Could provide you an interim relief also on this case.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. And to that extent, you can keep your balance unutilized. But there is a fair chance of getting an interim relief from Rajasthan High Court.
Okay, sir. Sure. Okay, sir. Thank you.
I hope I answered your question.
Yeah. Sir, I was just wondering, I mean, how can a service being used to manufacture a product, how can law stop from getting a refund of the same? I mean, I can't manufacture my product without that service.
I am saying even capital goods. I am actually going one step ahead.
Right, sir. Even capital goods.
That it's capital goods, because without capital goods, can I conduct my business? Now, if the intention of the law was very clear that inverted duty structure problem had to be removed, it has to be removed in complete sense. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense.
Right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, good evening, sir. This is Nilesh Solanki.
Yes, Mr. Solanki.
Sir, my question is there any interest liability on short payment or delay payment of tax liability, even I am having a input tax credit?
So if there is your question is that there is a short payment of tax liability, but you had credit accumulated and
yes,
you missed
yes.
by mistake or something.
Yes, yes. There should not be any interest liability.
No, sir.
Okay. And this.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello, sir. Girish here.
Yeah, Girish.
Hello.
Girish,
I wanted to ask. So we have paid the service and the service regime. But
yeah. Yes, Girish, please go ahead. I request Hello? Others to please mute. I request others to who are not speaking to please mute so that I can hear the person who's asking the question. It's my request, please.
Hello?
Yes, please.
The service provider has paid the service tax, but he has not raised the invoice. Okay, so now whether the recipient can claim the input credit by filing transition return?
Can you please repeat your question? Your voice was breaking.
The service provider has paid the service tax, but has not raised the invoice. So now whether the recipient can claim the credit by filing transition return?
You have 3-year period as per the decision of the brand equity. You will have to see your facts specifically. I had mentioned that two sections which would come into play now is section 140 subsection 5, where erstwhile tax invoices were not recorded within 30 days. You are falling within that situation because you would have not recorded the erstwhile service tax invoices within that period of 30 days from the date of the implementation of GST. If that is your situation and the amount involved is, then I think, Girish, you should file the writ petition in light of this brand equity case.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Yeah, thanks. Can we go to the next question, please?
Yes, sir. One more query. Myself, Nilesh Solanki.
Yes, sir.
Sir, as you are aware, the Class 120 of Finance Act 2020 amended Section 16.4.
Yes, sir.
And they are dealing the debit note with a invoice. So now, can we raise the debit note for the year 17-18 and my recipient can take the ITC of the same, sir?
Absolutely. That's what the intention is, right?
Yeah, but the amendment has notified, sir.
16.4 amendment has come. I will have to check that.
Yeah.
16.4 amendment had come.
Come.
Yeah. 16.4 amendment had happened.
Yeah.
So you can take the benefit of that amendment.
We can take the amendment. But sir, as we have been given to understand that it's not notified so far.
I don't think so. It's notified yet.
Oh, is it? So I will check that and come back to you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Dinesh, I'll respond back to you.
Yeah. I have raised the query.
There are some notifications which have notified the dates also recently.
Okay.
Like the section 140 notified date has come in. So I'll just check that and I'll respond.
Okay. Thank you.
Sir, this is Vijay Gopal here.
Yeah, Vijay.
Sir, at the time of implementation of GST, we have actually come across a situation where service tax was discharged on the advances received from our customers. And as per section 142.11, there is an option under 142.11C, whatever the service tax is discharged on the advances in the pre-GST regime, so that we can take it as an input tax credit and carry it forward. But for the reasons prevailing at that time, we have taken shelter under 142.11A and said that because the advance amount was already subjected to tax under service tax, so that portion of the amount should not be levied GST under the GST GST scenario. And as such, after the against those particular advances, if any invoices are to be raised, then what we are doing? We are adjusting that particular service tax from the GST and remitting the balance GST. So at that time, there was a confusion whether to go under 142.11A or under 142.11C. But for some XYZ reasons, we have gone under 142.11A. Today, after 3 years, is there any clarity in this particular issue?
Now, see, if you see provisions of 11A, subsection 11A, it says very clearly 142.11A, notwithstanding anything contained in section 12, no tax shall be payable on goods under this act to the extent the tax was levyable on the said goods under the value added tax of the state. You are referring to this provision, right?
It is 11B also, sir. 11A is 11B. About goods. 11B.
No tax shall be payable on services under this act to the extent the tax was levyable on the said services under the Finance Act.
Yeah.
Now, see, understand the law is very clear. that with respect to these services where there are either milestones or whether there is a consideration which is received in part. If part of that consideration has been subject to the erstwhile taxes, the tax need not be paid again on that transaction. Now, if the invoice has been raised for the erstwhile regime within the stipulated time and all compliances with respect to those transactions in part have been done, then there is no need to raise the GST invoice. The only question which would be relevant is that how the transition of the taxes would come with respect to those invoices and whether you have received that within time or not. And that's why what I am saying is that if you have missed the deadline of those 30 days, return, etc., or the transition of that credit into the new regime, you can take benefit of the brand equity decision now and take that credit if it has been missed by 30th of June by filing an intimation to your tax office.
If you have missed that credit, my point is that we have received certain advances from the client and on that we have discharged. There is no tax invoice raised under the service tax regime. Because whatever the advance we have received, we have discharged the service tax. So one argument is that... even before 1st July... Pardon?
You have discharged the liability.
Yeah, we have discharged the liability under service tax regime only. On the advances received. Yeah, yeah. Right. So now
there is no requirement to pay the tax again.
Yeah, but 142C says 142.11C says that whatever the tax has been paid in those cases, particularly which covers the advance cases, we can take it in the form of an input tax credit and under GST make the full payment of GST.
Now what C says, where tax was paid on any supply of goods, goods is not relevant, and under Chapter 5 of the Finance Act, tax shall be levyable under this act and the taxable person shall be entitled to take credit of value add tax or service tax paid under the existing law to the extent the supplies made after the appointed date. So basically what it says is that if the supplies are made after the appointed date, then shall be entitled to take credit of either the VAT or the service tax paid under the existing law, right? And such tax shall be calculated in such manner as may be prescribed. So C11C is for the credit, sir. Vijayji, understand. 11C is with respect to availment of those credit with respect to those erstwhile taxes for which the spillover has happened from the earlier regime to the current regime. To charging of the tax in any case has been charged because at that point of time Finance Act provided that when the invoices are raised in advance, the tax also has to be discharged in advance, right? Because at that point of time, the point of taxation would kick in for the receipt of money or the invoice raised, whichever is earlier. So as far as the output tax liability is concerned, that you have discharged the burden.
Correct.
So there is no dispute on that, sir.
Okay.
I hope I heard that.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Sir, there is one question regarding anti-profiteering.
Yeah.
In the recent order of Aster Infra, which I think you had argued, we saw that you had withdrawn the prayer regarding constitutional validity of 171.
Yeah.
Whereas the similar prayer is still pending before Delhi High Court itself in other matters. So,
right.
What do you think will be the likelihood of a favorable prayer being granted?
May I know your name, please?
This is Prateek.
Prateek?
Yeah.
Prateek, you are from which entity?
I am a chartered accountant.
You are a chartered accountant. So, Prateek, if as an advocate you were to ask me for that matter for which I am arguing a dozen of petitions, I would obviously say that the constitutional validity will have to be tested. And if you see, and I think you have done some homework with respect to anti-profiteering, and that's why you are asking such a specific question on Aster, the case which I argued, you would appreciate that the first writ petition which was filed in Delhi High Court for pyramid infrastructure was also argued by me. That had basically set the trend Now, why that had set the trend was that that issue was very important, because not only the challenge was with respect to the constitutional validity of 171, absence of methodology, jurisdiction, appellate mechanism, and how much money should be paid at the stage of the stay. So that had set the trend. Now, if you see basically in nutshell, if I were to answer this, today as we speak also for different sectors, there is no methodology to determine the quantum of profiteering. Now, what we are arguing before court is that it is not the case where we do not intend to transfer the benefit of profiteering. But the moot point still remains is that how that quantum of profiteering needs to be determined. Whether these two factors are the relevant factors or whether these two factors are the only factors to determine the quantum of profiteering to reach onto the conclusion of commensurate reduction of prices. There is a decision in the case of Shreya Singhal versus Union of India for 66A of the Information Technology Act for that messaging, menacing messaging and so on and so forth. The question there was with respect to the principle which I have also used in my argument before Gujarat High Court, wherein the Gujarat High Court held the pre-import condition to be unconstitutional or ultra-vires the foreign trade policy. Now, the principle which I use there is still the principle which I'm using for anti-profiteering, which is the doctrine of void for vagueness. If the Act provides for a phrase which is like commensurate reduction of prices, without providing a methodology to determine the quantum of profiteering and reaching the conclusion of what is commensurate, is it fair and logical for the taxpayer to determine the quantum of profiteering, pass on to that benefit when there is no methodology? Anti-profiteering authorities for the real estate for different 17 players have reached out to different conclusions, wherein in most of the cases there is profiteering, but in few of the cases there is no profiteering. In most of the cases, the profiteering varies from 0.5% to 8.5%. If that is the variation, is there a requirement to have the methodology is the question, Prateek, which we need to ask. Not only us, but the GST Council and also the Union of India. And that's what we've been doing in all of these dozens of petitions. Now, coming on to Aster, the facts were not there before the tax bench. The facts were there before the criminal bench. And it was prudent at that point of time to park the question with respect to constitutional validity of Section 171. Because if 171 gets decided, even for one player and is held to be unconstitutional, that would not make any difference to my life, Prateek. But that day, if that judge in a particular bench would have held that provision to be constitutional, my dozen of writs would have been under radar as far as, so I will have to then use the principle of sub silentio to create a distinction between that writ and other writs. So if I get the decision in any of the writs with respect to the constitutionality, that becomes the law of the land. So I have no quarrel there or any hardship there. So yes, early days still, but if you ask me as an advocate, there are fair chances that the constitutionality will have to be decided by court either at this stage or at the apex court stage.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah. I think we are running out of time. So there is some other meeting. If we can be very briefly, if another...
We'll very brief and just try to address as many questions. Yeah, sure. I'll be brief.
No.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Sir, this question is when we file the Tranche 1, we are not taken the credit of education session SHE. There is a Madras High Court judgment. What is the remedy if you wanted to take the credit right now?
Now, there is a retrospective amendment which has happened, which has made our life miserable. You need to challenge that retrospective amendment and then take the credit. There is an option of other reasons by which you can take the credit. You should take the credit and not utilize it. Keep it pending till the matter is finally decided. If the amount involved in your case is much higher, then you should basically file the writ petition.
Because Tran 1 is not open, so I could not able to avail the credit in Tran 1.
You can you need not avail it in Tran 1. You can avail it at different places which are there today also in any other.
Okay.
Any other. It says any other.
Okay.
You can take so it there, but not utilize it.
Okay. I have another question, sir. See, this ITC 02 for transfer of under Section 18.3. Okay. This is allowing only within the state transfer. It is not allowing from transfer from Tamil Nadu to Madras, if a business transfer, it is not allowing because there is a clear order from the state authority. It is allowed the transfer of ITC, but ITC security is not operational for transfer of interstate transfer. We approached to the department help desk. Now there is no solution. Is it advisable to file a writ in Mumbai High Court?
You can basically write to the highest authority, which is the Revenue Secretary, and try with the Revenue Secretary by sending on an email. And if that doesn't happen, the best way is to file a writ petition.
Because this receiving state assistant commissioners pass an order because you are not eligible for credit.
You please write to the Revenue Secretary.
Pardon?
Yeah, you can do that. But I think the best way before that would be to write to the Revenue Secretary and then go to the court.
Because there is a order denying this credit in the receiving GSTN. So we can challenge in the Bombay High Court instead of going to the...
Absolutely. Absolutely. You can do that.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Next question, please. We'll move a little faster, please. For those people who have not asked any question, if they want to ask any question, please. Yes, Darshan.
See, if there's a 2-year of limitation for filing a refund application, it's the in. Right. So let's
inverted
say.
Inverted duty. Yeah.
No, not inverted. In case of exports under.
Okay. LUD. Yeah, there is a limitation. Yes, there is a limitation prescribed in the Act.
So what happens if that is like that's over? Is there any way to get those?
See, the period of limitation which is prescribed in the Act is 2 years. You will have to follow the provisions of the statute when it comes to this limitation. The only thing what you can try is basically if you have missed some big deadline is to use this brand equity case which provides the period of limitation of 3 years by referring to the Limitation Act. So you will have to challenge that period of 2 years to get the benefit.
Okay, so it's like better to go and file the application and let the department decide.
Yes, yes. But at the same time, if the quantum is very high, then you can see that at what stage you will have to move to the court by creating a cause of action.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Next question, please. I think we can take last two questions. Last two questions, please.
Sir, this is my last question. Actually,
yes,
as per rule 138, e-way bill validity, there is a validity for every e-way bill, depend upon kilometer. If I receive that inward material after expired of validity, is there any issue for our business?
Like, see, it's a procedural thing which is mentioned there. It's a procedural thing which is mentioned there. Now, substantive benefits cannot be denied due to procedural lapse. But from the government standpoint, I think it is always better to have those rectifications or get it issued again.
Okay. Because that within 72 hours, if I have not done anything, that should be deemed to be accepted that e-way bill. In our security, inverted after expired of validity. So I'm not going to lose ITC, but I can avail the ITC, but at the time of auditing.
There will be a problem. There can be a problem. That's what I'm saying. It's a procedural aspect. So substantive right cannot be denied, but you should have that in place and try to get that in place because your intention is very clear.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Next question, please.
Sir, in case of labor contract, the GST should be charged on entire amount of salary or only the part of service charges?
It will completely depend on the way the word of the contract is there. The valuation basically provides for the entire consideration to be charged. So that's the hardship. But you will have to structure your contracts in such a way so that you paid it only on the margin.
Okay.
That is possible. Yeah, thanks. Next question, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
So I'm from insurance industry and we have set up a new branch and therefore work contract services issue for the whole contract invoice, not given a separate invoice for the AC or interior design or construction amount. So we can take a credit of whole amount, or we can reverse the whole amount under Section 17, Section 5.
The only problem in Section 17, 5C and 5D are that there are restrictions with respect to the works contract when these are used for construction of immovable property. If the invoice uses that as a works contract for construction of immovable property, then there will be a restriction which will be placed. The better thing for you would be to either break the service contract in such a way that only the works contract is there in a separate invoice and other services are there in a separate invoice. But if you are unable to do that, please challenge 17.5C.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else for the question?
I think all the questions have been answered probably, I feel.
Yeah. Ira, would you want to announce about the next session which we want to have, wherein we can also cover the recent developments and probably, or you want to put that by way of an email only later, at a later stage?
I think we can maybe put an email. We have all the names, so we can definitely put our email. So I think we come to the end of this webinar. Indeed, this has been a very excellent webinar, very enriching, very focused, and I think one of the best webinars maybe which I've attended in the recent times. I believe all of you would also endorse that. I would like to thank from FICCI side Mr. Rastogi for taking out his time and sharing valuable insights, and most importantly, patiently answering to all the queries. I believe all the queries would have been answered. So thank you very much. And I would also like to thank each one of you for taking out your time and attending this webinar. We hope that you have really benefited out of the discussions. And we look forward to further interactions, more interactions which are like more focused and where the queries are really answered. So we look forward to further interactions. We will be coming up maybe with another series or of webinars. We would also like you to maybe send in your suggestions, the areas where you would like us to do webinars on, that you can also share with us, and also your feedback. So that would be really important. So thank you everyone. And stay safe, stay positive, and stay connected. So we will be in touch. Yeah, sure. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you so much, everybody. Stay safe, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.